Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our services here today at Water's Edge. We're just so happy that you're with us. And, you know, there's a very encouraging verse, at least to me personally, in Proverbs. Chapter 16 says, a person plans their way in their mind, but the Lord directs their steps. So isn't that good to know that it's okay for us to make plans and have, you know, goals and desires, but if we're serving the Lord, He's going to direct our steps. He's such a good God that if I get off on the wrong track, He'll bring me back on the right track because He's for me. He's my Heavenly Father. He's your Heavenly Father. And so we just want to encourage you with that great comfort that the Lord is directing your steps if you want to. And if you don't want to, obviously He's not. But the Lord will direct our steps as we submit to Him. But we have a great report on missions today. Emily's going to come up and update us on missions and what God is doing in our church and around the world. And Emily recently gave me a book to read, and it's ruining me. That book is ruining me. Such a challenging story. But thank you for sharing it with me.
Hey, this looks like a pretty good crowd today. Wow. Okay, I have had a request about pictures that go along with your list of missionaries so that you're able to pray effectively for them because you have a picture. And may I encourage you to get all of the prayer cards. I have mine all connected by my desk, so when I pray, I have them, I know them, and I know their needs. So may I encourage you, out on the desk are many cards, and they just sit there. But this will help you to be an effective prayer warrior for our missions. Number two, let's see, what do we have to put up? Amanda, do we have the flower? Good. There we go. In April, our church gave $2,751.60 for missions. Woo! Do you know we need to be on target, you look at the picture now, 1,330 some dollars. You are very, very faithful. And I just personally, Pastor, want to thank everybody. If we keep going, we will be able to give our missionaries a raise. Won't that be wonderful if we can do that? Because everybody likes a raise. Right, Daniel?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. Last time, when Brother Gross was here, and you remember he's our missions man for the state of Ohio, he was encouraging us to be concerned about the Buddhist and the Hindu nations. Do you remember that? And he was saying something that is extremely important. We need youth. I remember David and I went when Becky Ann was about 7 to Africa. You know what? When you get our age, Barb, that doesn't sound so interesting. But when you're younger, you can be a part of missions. Whether it's doing like Jessica did in the church, or whether it's going on a maps trip, or saying yes to God full time. Have you ever considered it? Have you ever prayed about it? Let me challenge you this summer. There's going to be a lot of kids at camp across Ohio and around the United States. Would you pray with me that God would speak to their heart not to make money, not to become famous, but to say yes to God. Jordan, you let God speak to you. Let him use you. I want to tell you a story real quick about one teenager and what she did for missions. Her name is Lillian Trasher. She was engaged to be married by God. When God speaks to your heart, things change. So Lillian had been to missions meetings and she had heard the challenge of missionaries. And wow, God moved. Well, what do you do with a marriage that's 10 days away from happening when the mate that you have says, I don't think so. I don't think so. I'll wait for you when you come home. But she never planned on coming home. And the wedding was called off. She heard a speaker talk about Egypt. And wow, God said, that's where I want you. And to prove in her heart that God was speaking to her life as a very young person, Acts chapter 7, verse 54 or 34. Kim, will you read that out loud, real loud?
But you will receive power when the Holy Ghost comes upon you. And you will be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth.
I can't hear you. Well, we'll just make sure we do. Acts chapter 7.
You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. You will be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth.
And that was her call. So she and her sister got on a boat. Did an airplane? Nope. Boat. With $100 in her pocket. And she followed the voice of God. When she got to Egypt, what was she going to do? You know what? God leads you. And do you realize that a baby that was dying had a baby? And that lady gave her baby to Lillian? Now what? Well, it repeated and repeated and repeated. And all of a sudden, what do you do with all them babies? Lillian Trasher opened an orphanage in 1911. Faithful, faithful, faithful. Not only did she have orphans, she had widows. And the orphanage grew. She heard God. She was faithful. And do you know that Lillian Trasher died in 1961, and that orphanage has ministered, helped, encouraged over 20,000 orphans. That orphanage is still going, and they are supported 85% from the Egyptian church. You know what? Allow God to speak to your heart. Allow God to speak to your heart. Because, as Brother Gross said, we need to pray for laborers in the mission field. chapter 10, verse 22, is exactly what needs to take place.
These were his instructions to them. The harvest is great, but the workers are few. So pray to the Lord who is in charge of the harvest, ask him to send more workers into his field.
Will you pray for camps that the Lord will speak? Introducing Mama Trasher in Egypt. And those are all her children. Never married, never had kids, but she had 20,000 come through the orphanage.
Thank you.
With the worship team and come this morning, we're going to worship the Lord together today. We've got a lot to worship Him about. We're getting a new sanctuary finished up, hopefully this week. Pray for your pastor. It's been a tough week. But it's going to be a better week this week as they finish up, we get everything done. And the fact that Jesus Christ is Lord of all. Amen?
Amen.
So why don't you stand with me this morning? Let's open with a word of prayer. Father, we come before you today truly grateful that you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Father, I thank you that you call people like us. Lord, I thank you that you spoke into the heart of a young woman named Lily to leave everything behind, to follow your voice, not knowing where she was going to go and becoming the mother of all these children, to be the encourager of all these widows. And Father, I pray that each one of us would recognize that you have a plan for us. Now let your kingdom come into this place. Let your will be done. Help us to hear your voice today, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Let's worship Him this morning as we sing a song that says, "Faith, strength will rise as you wait upon the Lord." How many could use a little more strength today? A few more? Yeah. Well, let's believe God for the strength that He has for us. Let's sing out this morning and celebrate the goodness of God. We will wait upon the Lord. Aren't you glad for that strength that rises up within us when the power of the Spirit enters a place? And this morning, I believe that's what the Holy Spirit wants. He wants to enter this place. So, Father, today, I just open myself up to you. Lord, I believe that you have brought us here for purpose. Lord, not just to have another Sunday morning, not just another time of getting together, but you have something specific for each one of us, something life-changing. And I pray that we will walk in that, we will receive it. Lord, anything that would hinder you today, I pray that it would be rebuked. I pray that it would be broken. And Father, that your glory would be revealed to us in this place. Father, I thank you that you've done so much for us. And there's still so much left to be done. Thank you that we can trust you in all of that. Lord, we give you glory in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Let's continue worshiping him this morning. I've got more than 10,000 reasons to worship him. Let's do it today. Oh, bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul. Worship your holy name. The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. So bless the Lord, my soul. Oh,
This is the air I breathe.
Thank you.
Thank you. guide us into all truth. What is really truth? What is reality, basically? And you know, the truth is, without God, I am really totally hopeless. I am totally weak without Him. Jesus said that apart from God, we can do nothing, really nothing of eternal value. I've actually had people say to me in life, in conversations, that they felt they were just totally lost in the world. And really, that's true. If we don't have the Lord, if we don't know the Lord, we are totally lost in the world. But the good news is, if you have a desire, if you have a hunger, that God is here today, and He'll give you that purpose. He'll give you that hope. He'll give you what reality truly is if you merely call out to Him and ask. He will minister to you right where you're sitting, right where you're standing. He is in our midst today. The Holy Spirit is real, and He's here today. Let's call out to Him. Heavenly Father, thank You for giving us everything. Lord, we really have nothing without You. Thank You for Jesus as our Savior and healer and deliverer. Thank You, God, for giving us Holy Spirit as the helper, as the comforter, as the one that guides us into all truth. And Lord, my prayer is for those today that may be seeking the truth of God, may be seeking the purpose of their life, where are they at in life, that they would know that, God, that You're here, and that You will just manifest Yourself to them today in a way that they would know it's You speaking.
Yes.
Thank You, Lord, that we have hope, that we have purpose. And Lord, thank You that we can recognize that we're weak, that we can become strong in You as we rely upon You, as we put our trust in You. And may our hope, Lord, be in You and Your goodness, not on my religiosity, not on my spirituality, but my hope is in You, Lord. Thank You today for Your presence. Thank You for helping us and guiding us. Holy Spirit, continue to have Your way in our midst today. That all the glory be brought to You, God. Love You. Thank You. Thank You, Lord, for hearing our prayers. And Lord, we ask these things in the wonderful name of Jesus, our Savior. And everyone said, amen. 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 God bless you. You may be seated. We will go ahead and dismiss the children and all those involved in children's ministry. They will be released. This weekend is, actually tonight starts our yearly, it's called Network Conference. Pastor Rusty and I will be going to be attending that for all the ministers in Ohio up in Youngstown. So we'll not have any church events tonight, except we will have youth. Ed will be leading the youth tonight at the room from 5 o'clock right there. 5 o'clock right there in the church. Tuesday will be the helmsman. The men gather at 6 o'clock on Tuesday night here at the church. Wednesday will be our midweek midweek Bible study online with Pastor Rusty at 7 o'clock on Facebook, Rusty and Tish Foley. Thursday will be, for those of you with green thumbs, will be flower planting with the Licking County Parks Department. So what do you have a green thumb or anything else, I think all hands will be greatly appreciated. So if you'd like to have a flower planting to be a blessing to our Parks Department, we would appreciate that. And then Saturday is May 22nd, is Discipleship Kids to the Works. And Tish needs to give out permission slips today, needs to know today. Children are going to attend that, so please let her know today if you're going to go to Discipleships to the Works. And remember, June 6th will be our kids' blast, so we still need people to take signs, take invitations. It'll be held this year right after church service, so it'll be kind of a unique opportunity to minister to our community. I think that's it, Pastor Rusty, wherever he is.
All right. Thank you, Pastor Rick. Am I live? There I am. Yeah. Sounds a little different. Wouldn't think scenes and carpet would change that much, but it has. Well, it's good to have you all here with us this morning, and I am glad for the presence of God. How about you?
Amen.
I'm reminded of what Moses said, if you don't go with us, then we don't want to leave. And my thought is, if God doesn't go with me, there's no place I want to go in this world. There's nothing I want to do if God isn't there with me. If He isn't doing it with me, it's not worth doing. And so this morning, I just want to celebrate the fact that He is here, and He's here because He loves us. Did you know that? loves you. So look at the person next to you and say, he loves you.
Love you.
That's right. Some of you needed to be reminded of that fact. He does love you. And not only the scripture, John 3:16 tells us that God loves you so much. By the way, you are the world. You knew that, right? But it says, for God so loved the world, that's you. He loves you so much that he gave his one and only son to die for your sins so that you wouldn't have to die because of your sins. And as you receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, then your life is transformed. You become a child of the King. You get to go to heaven and be with him forever. Doesn't that sound like a great plan? So today we're going to be looking at the outcome of that. The fact that the scripture says it's appointed unto each man once to die, and after that comes judgment. And so the title of the message this morning is 1 minute after you die. That's an uplifting statement, isn't it?
Don't get uncomfortable.
1 minute after you die. Now, there should be some folks here that are going to help hand out. We've got timers here. So the folks that are helping to pass off the timers, if you come, there's a basket of them. There's some here on both sides. But go ahead and get these out in folks' hands. I want you to take these home, and I want this to be a reminder to you. Just grab handfuls of them and pass them around. And I want this to be a reminder of you. Let me grab this. I like the orange. I want the orange. Now, this isn't how long I'm going to preach, okay? Sorry about that. Maybe it is. I don't know that anything's coming through it right now. No, they're staying in the bottom. But anyways, I want you to put these somewhere in your home where you will see it. And every time you see it, I want you to turn it over, because probably every time you see it, all the sand is going to be in one end, right? Flip that over and take a moment to think, what's going to happen the first moment after I die? That's what I want you to. I want you to use this for that. We're in a series. I'll be explaining it coming up. But over the next 3 weeks, we're in a series. What 1 minute after you die? And so I want this in somewhere where you're going to see it every day. And every time you see it, I want you to turn it over. And while that sand is running, I want you to ask yourself that question: what is going to happen 1 minute after I die? So has everybody got one? We all got one? Good. I'm going to put mine right here. Is that okay, Blue? He's my neighbor. He waits for me to come out and mow the grass and can leave at me. So this morning, 1 minute after you die, the fact is, we're looking at life after death. Really, as a matter of fact, did you know you really don't die? It is appointed unto one man, each person wants to die. That's the physical body. But how many of you know that the physical body is just a shell? I know I've got differences of opinion with different people. My grandfather worked at a funeral home. He ran his own grocery. He owned his own grocery store for years and years and years, and he was a butcher. But after he retired, he took a job at a funeral home, and he'd get so frustrated with me because I'd look at, and if this is you, please don't take offense at what I'm going to say here, but I'd look at how much they paid for the casket and the headstone and the plot and the vault and the service and all the things that go along with a funeral. And I told him, look, just put me in a brown paper bag, throw me in a dumpster, and spend the money on me now. That was my thought, because I it's just ingrained in me. I know I've got family members that go to funeral plots and fix flowers and things. That's great, and I'm glad that they enjoy that. And that's something. But for me, after my parents died and were placed at the cemetery there in Lima, I've never gone back, because that's not a point of reference for me. My point of reference is the life that they lived, and my greatest point of reference is they ain't there. They're up there with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And 1 minute after they die, That's what we're going to talk about today. So if you'll join me in your Bibles to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. We're going to begin in verse 1. There's a lot of scripture in here. It's all on, should mostly all be on the overhead. I apologize. I added a few after I sent out the rough draft for. And by the way, Mariah does an incredible job. Don't they look so much better than when I did them? It's like going from stick people to somebody that really knows what they're doing. So, thank you. Yeah. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 1 says, our bodies are like tents. How many of you have ever slept in a tent? All right. How many of you enjoy sleeping in a tent? You enjoy sleeping in a tent? Yeah. For me, I remember when we were raising the kids, we went tent camping. And it was great until one day Tish woke up in the middle of the night and I said, what are you doing? She said, I'm going up to the restroom. And I said, well, I'll walk up with you. So I got my tennis shoes on, got up, and we're walking along and something caught my eye and I turned the flashlight and there was a skunk with his tail aimed right at us. And I put my arm out and I stopped it. I turned off the light. I waited and pretty soon turned on the light and he was gone. So I started thinking, you know what? Working all year long, saving up our money and our time so that we can spend 2 weeks acting homeless. That's right after that, we bought the camper. That's because that tent, and to tell you the truth, I think I know where that old tent is. I was done with it. I folded it up. I put it away. It's gotten moved a few times, but that tent don't mean nothing to me no more. And that's the way this body is. It says our bodies are like tents. I mean, I try to exercise. I try to take care of it. But one day it's going to turn into dust. Our bodies are like tents that we live in here on earth. But when these tents are destroyed, we know that God will give each of us a place to live. These homes will not be buildings that someone has made, but they are in heaven and will last forever. While we're here on earth, we sigh because we want to live in that heavenly home. We want to put it on like clothes and not be naked. So always be cheerful. As long as we're in these bodies, we are away from the Lord. But we live by faith, not by sight, what we see. We should be cheerful because we would rather leave these bodies and be at home with the Lord. You ever feel like that? But whether we are at home with the Lord or away from Him, we still try our best to please Him. After all, listen to this. Christ will judge each of us for the good or bad that we do while living in these bodies. Father, this morning, as we consider time, only 1 minute of it. As we consider time, the moment that we find ourselves standing in your presence, Father, as we consider time, help us to grasp the fact that there's so much that you want to show us this morning about our time. Be glorified in this place, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So, what is our goal in this life? As we look at this scripture, what is our goal in this life? Well, from what this scripture tells me, first, my goal is to please Jesus Christ. I want to please Him with everything I've done. You know, the thing that disturbed me the most growing up and still does is when someone is disappointed in me. Anybody else? You have that family? I remember my daughter Rachel was named after Rachel Shealy, and Rachel Shealy was a close friend of the family. She just passed away at 102 years old a few years ago. And Rachel was this lady that I distinctly remember disappointing her. I played around and didn't do well with my grades. And so I wasn't too worried about it. You know, my parents were upset about it. I had been through it before. We were going to get, yeah. And I remember Mom went over to Montgomery Ward where Rachel worked, and Rachel always held back dresses for my mom and put them off to the side. And when Mom would come in, she'd bring out these dresses and Mom would try them on. And so while Mom's trying on the dresses, Rachel's standing out there talking to me. And my real name is Tim. And everyone called me Rusty except Rachel. It was Tim, always. And I distinctly remember her looking over the counter at me and saying, "Tim, I heard about your grades." And then she stuck the knife in and twisted. She said, "I'm so disappointed." It was awful. To this day, I'm 58 years old. I was 12. I still remember it. It still hurts when I think about it. That disappointment. And the fact is that I don't want to disappoint Jesus Christ. How about you? And so my goal is to please Jesus Christ. My second goal is to live for him. Because what? He died for me. What greater thing could I do? What less thing could I do? I need to live for him. And third, to do what lasts for eternity. Are you doing what lasts for eternity? And the fact is, what you believe about eternity determines how you will live today. Amen?
Amen.
What you believe, if you believe eternity doesn't exist, it'll affect how you live today. If you know that there is an eternity and you will be in it, how long is eternity? I remember when I was a little kid growing up, when my Royal Ranger commander said, "Imagine, if you will, a bird that can fly from the earth to the moon." Okay, that'd take a while. No extra speed, regular speed, bird flies from the earth to the moon. And as he flies from the earth to the moon, he carries all that he can and still fly of the earth. Enough dirt, you can imagine. And so he flies all the way to the moon. Then he flies all the way back, and he gets the next fossil. And he flies to the moon and back, and he flies it until there is nothing left of the earth. He said, that's just the beginning of eternity. Eternity is forever, and our bodies are a tent that we fold up when we die, or someone else folds up. That is folded up when we die, but our spirit is still completely alive, completely aware, all together, and it will live forever. And what you believe about eternity determines how you live today. If you believe that the world came about as a cataclysmic explosion, that Big Bang that they talked about, then eternity is not that big a deal. By the way, for the Big Bang to have worked, I've had authors that have likened it unto if you went to a junkyard that was full of the parts of a 747 among all other pieces of junk, and in this junkyard are pieces spread out all over, buried, all kinds of things, pieces of the 747. A tornado comes through and hits that junkyard, and it spins things around, and all the pieces of that 747 come together into an airplane. The odds of the Big Bang actually taking place and us having all this, it's easier for the 747 to be put together by the tornado. Statistically speaking, Big Bang, nowhere close to 747 coming together. It's easier for the 747 to happen. Now, should that happen, how many of you are going to fly in that plane? Okay? So, Big Bang, if you believe it in Big Bang, that's what you're believing in. But if you believe it, that means you believe that you're just an accident. There's no master plan. There's no purpose for your life. You're just living to live. Therefore, you're believing that God doesn't really exist, which makes you into your own God. Hear what I'm saying? Then, if that all is true, then you will be living for yourself. And with that, others are only an ends to a means. The only purpose of others is to make your life better, and that's it. And the Bible is only a list of suggestions that really don't have a foundation. And your eternity could be compared to a fairy tale. Now, if you believe that the world was created by an almighty God with a plan, making you, listen to this, making you a masterpiece. I know we've done it before, but look at the person next to you and say, you're a masterpiece. George, you coughed. You didn't say it. Come on. Tell Sandy she's a masterpiece. Come on. You are a masterpiece. That you were planned out. Doesn't that sound like a masterpiece? You have a purpose. You have a design. And you recognize that Jehovah God is the God of everything. He is in complete control. Then, if that's true and you believe that, then you will live for Him. Through the saving blood of Jesus Christ, and other people are an opportunity for you to bring glory to Him. And other people will see that the Bible is the ultimate guide for your life, and they'll begin to look at it as the guide for theirs. And your eternity, your destiny, if you believe, embrace, excuse me, and live all of that, then I can describe your eternity with three letters. Why? W-O-W. If you believe, if you embrace that, if you live that, listen to me. Eternity is how long? Forever and ever and ever and ever. And if you have Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, your eternity is summed up in the word, wow. Amazing. Because God has created a place for you. And the series that we're looking at the next few weeks, 1 minute after you die, today, just to give you a roadmap, today, you will always live somewhere. And that's what we're going to be talking about today. The fact of eternity. You will always live some. There's not a point where the lights go out for your spirit. This is a huge point. There is no time when the lights will ever go out on your spirit. I can't help but wonder if that isn't why we dream. Even though our body is asleep, our spirits are still awake within us. How would you like it if someone said, yeah, for 8 hours a day, I'm going to take a nap and you sit there and wait on me? It'd probably get you moving around. So that might be it, but the fact is, your spirit will always be awake and somewhere. Next week, Pastor Rick is going to talk about the horrors of hell, because there is a hell that we need to know about. And if it's going to be for an eternity, we want to know why. We don't want to be there for an eternity. And then the third week, Pastor Rick and I are going to tag team on the glory of heaven and the eternity that God has for us. Now, this morning as I begin this, I want to read a quote from a fellow by the name of Erwin Lutzer. He's an author and a pastor. He said, 1 minute after you slip behind the parted curtain, you will either be enjoying a personal welcome from Christ or be catching your first glimpse of gloom as you have never known it. Either way, your future will be irrevocably fixed and eternally unchangeable. At that moment, that's it. Now, with that in mind, there are three things that happen to you once this life is done. First, our physical bodies die. If you look at Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27, it says, we die only once. Now, I know Hollywood has made different pictures and authors have written different things to bring people back to life. Let me tell you something. Only one person conquered death, and that was Jesus Christ. And he conquered it so that we could conquer it. Now, you might say, what about Lazarus? Well, he eventually died, though, didn't he? But Jesus died, and then he rose again so that we could live forever. So the scripture says, we die only once, and then we are judged. We need to keep that in mind. It goes on and says, so Christ died only once to take away the sins of many people. But when he comes again, it will not be to take away sin. He will come to save everyone who is waiting for him. Did you know that? He's coming for those that are waiting for him. How do you wait? You ever been to the airport when someone's coming home after a long trip? They've been away for a long time. Now, we can't do it the same way we used to. It used to be right there when they got off the plane, but there's too much security now. But you ever been in the airport where people are waiting for someone to come in that maybe they've been, a soldier's been deployed for 6 months, a year, haven't seen their family? And what kind of celebration is that? Can you imagine getting off that plane, walking through the restricted area only to find nobody there waiting on you when you came back? And Jesus Christ is coming back for those who are looking for him. He will come to save everyone who is waiting for him. Now, scientists have proven an important fact in our study today. Out of every person who lives today, out of each and every one person that lives today, one will die. That's a deep fact, isn't it? I hear wheels squeaking right now. For every person that's alive is going to die. Scientists have proven that fact to be true. And so the question doesn't come down to, will I die? Now, I'm going to preface this. I don't have this in my notes. But I'm praying for Jesus' return, the trumpet sound. You all know I want to do the Superman pose when we go up. I'm hoping I have presence of mind. But that's my plan. But even there, you know, the body is transformed. The physical body that I have now is not going to stay the same. It'll be changed. And so as we look at that, the fact is, it's not about how I will, or if I will die, but it comes down to how I will die. Now, you may get a diagnosis from a doctor that says you have this disease and you have this long to live. You'd be one of the few that could say, well, I'm pretty sure how I'm going to die. But most of us have no idea. The fact is, I'm not afraid of dying. It's how it's going to happen that's got me a little concerned. Okay? Some of you, everybody has a fear of how they will die. I noticed a fellow was talking about this, and he was talking about sharks. I remember when we were down in Florida, we were all out in the ocean. The waves were huge. I was just talking about this story with some folks last week. Waves were huge coming in. It was so bad that Tish couldn't even get out in the water. I took her by the hand. I was trying to drag her out. He was pulling his boat back. Finally, she said, leave me alone. So I went out, and I was getting on the boogie board, and big wave had come in, man. I was riding all the way up and dropping it on the sand, and it was incredible. And so we're out there, and I'm not far from my daughter, Rachel, about the distance of me and Pastor Rick. And we're both fighting the waves, and we just got past the worst part, and just in front of us, we see a huge wave come up, and out of the wave came a shark's tail that was this tall. It looked like it was this tall. It was this tall. And it came out of the wave and right back in the water. I'd never seen that before in my life. Shark, I'm in the ocean. Rachel looks at me and says, what do we do? And I said, don't tell mom. every once in a while, we'd get in a situation like that. Was, don't tell mommy, okay? But the fact is, my thought is, there's too much ocean out here for me to be worried about him. I mean, sure, it happens, but let's look at the statistics. You're more likely to be killed by a champagne cork than by a shark. Did you know that? I don't know how it happens. Maybe it hits you at a soft point in the back. I don't know. Maybe it hits the chandelier over the table and drops. I don't know. But you're more likely to be killed by falling coconuts. Remember Gilligan's Island? You're more likely to be killed by falling coconuts than by a shark. You are, listen, this is serious. you are much more likely to be killed by bad handwriting than a shot. Yeah, I was waiting. I did the same thing. What? Yeah, a doctor. You ever tried to read a doctor's writing? They make a prescription out, and they send it, and the pharmacist fills it, and you die. You've got a better chance of dying from messy handwriting than from a shot. This is my favorite statistic right here. It's more likely you will die falling off the toilet. Did you know that? Yeah. Than dying from a shark attack. It's more likely you will die from a vending machine. They didn't get into details. I figured it fell over on you, but maybe it's something you ate. I don't know. But you're more likely to die from a vending machine than from a shark attack. But the bottom line is, you're dust. You started as dust, you ended as dust, and the product in the middle is the blessing of God. And what we do with that is so vitally important. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27 says, we die only once, and then we are judged. So Christ died only once to take away the sins of many people. But when he comes again, it will not be to take away sin. He will come to save everyone who is waiting. So, first, our physical bodies die. Second, our souls separate from our physical bodies. How many of you like me are saying, I'm ready for that to happen? I'm ready. The back won't bother me anymore. The shoulder, the sinuses. Man, if this past week was a week. I went out and I'm going to mow some grass. I mowed some grass. The wind was blowing and blowing across me. And I thought, phew. Later that day, I told Tish, I'm sick as a dog. Those my sinuses, all that hay fever, allergy, whatever it was. I'm ready to turn this puppy in for something that's glorified. And that's the fact our souls separate from our physical bodies. Matthew chapter 10, verse 28. Don't be afraid of people. They can kill you, but they cannot harm your soul. If we remember that, they cannot harm your soul. Instead, you should fear God, who can destroy both your body and then your soul in hell. Then don't be afraid of people, but we should be afraid of God, a reverent fear. I've mentioned it before. When my dad walked into the house and I heard him say, Russ, come here. There's always that pause told me so much. If it was a short pause, I'm in a little trouble. If it was a long pause, oh baby, start putting the net magazines in the back of my britches because something's coming. And I had that fear, that reverence, that appreciation for his authority. And that's what this is talking about, because one day your body will be placed in the ground, but your soul will continue on. When your body is in the ground, your soul, I believe, listen to me this morning. Excuse me, I should mute more. When your body is in the ground, your soul will be more alive, I believe, than it has ever been before. Think about this. When your body is out, how much time do you spend focusing on the physical part of life? And when that is gone, and your soul, I believe, will be more alive than ever before. Jesus, speaking to Martha, considering Lazarus, said in John chapter 11, verse 25, then Jesus said, I am the one who raises the dead to life. Everyone who has faith in me will live, even if they die. And everyone who lives because of faith in me will never really die. Remember at the beginning I said we never really die? That's what the scripture says. And everyone who lives because of faith in me will never really die. And then he asks an important question. Do you believe this? And my question this morning is, well, do you? Do we really believe this? That Those that believe in him will never really die. So it brings me to the question of, what happens to the soul when the body dies? What takes place? We've got scripture that tells us different things. It doesn't give us a fine timeline of, as soon as we die, this is what happens. You know, I know I've been to the funerals, and I remember being at a funeral of somebody I loved dearly, and they said, oh yeah, I'm sure they're here today enjoying this. And I thought, they've been here all their life, and heaven's in front of them. You think they're coming back here to enjoy a funeral? Even their own? No, as we consider this fact, the fact that, Jesus Christ gives us life, do we really believe that? And what happens to the soul when the body dies? We don't know exactly, but we do know some things that we've been told through the Word of God. We do know that there were two thieves on the cross next to Jesus. Both of them hurling insult at him as he was dying, as they were dying. But then one had a change of heart. He saw all that Jesus did and what he spoke. And the man looked at him and said, remember me when you enter your kingdom. And what did Jesus say? Today, you will be with me in paradise. That's pretty quick. Paul said, to be absent from the body is to be present from the Lord. He said, to live is Christ and to die is gain. We want to look at Philippians chapter 1, verse 20. He said, I honestly expect and hope that I will never do anything to be ashamed of. Well, wouldn't that be a life to attain? I honestly expect and hope that I will never do anything to be ashamed of. Whether I live or die, I always want to be as brave as I am now and bring honor to Christ. I think I need to make that my mantra for the rest of my life. It goes on and says in verse 21, if I live, it will be for Christ. And if I die, I will gain even more. I don't know what to choose. I could keep on living and doing something useful. It is a hard choice to make. I want to die and be with Christ because that would be much better. So, as we discussed, physical bodies always die. And at that point, the soul separates from the body. Number three, we will all face judgment. We will all face judgment. Hebrews 9:17 says, we die only once, and then we are judged. So how are we judged? 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 17 says, you say that God is your Father, but God doesn't have favorites. Now, some people would say that contradicts what I say. When I tell people, I'm God's favorite child. He doesn't love anybody more than he loves me. But you're God's favorite child because he doesn't love anybody more than he loves you. And that's what this scripture is saying. He doesn't have, everybody's his favorite. So he can't say one is. You say that God is your Father, but God doesn't have favorites? He judges all people by what they do. So you must honor God or live in reverent fear of him while you live as strangers on this earth. How does God judge? He judges all people by what they do. And judgment, when we get to this point, what does judgment look like? Well, the scripture tells us there's going to be two different judgments. One judgment is the great white throne judgment. This is one that you do not want to be at. The judgment for non-believers, those who have lived and died without loving and serving Jesus Christ. That's the great white throne judgment. Revelation chapter 20, verse 11 says, I saw a great white throne with someone sitting on it. Earth and heaven tried to run away. You talk about something that's bad? Everyone, everything tried to run away from this judgment. But there was no place for them to go. I also saw all the dead people standing in front of that throne. Every one of them was there, no matter who they had once been. Several books were open, and then the book of life was open. The dead were judged by those books, by what those books said they had done. Anyone, listen to this, anyone whose name wasn't written in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire. You see, when Jesus receives someone to be his child, to be his servant, when someone makes Jesus Christ their Lord, he has written in the Lamb's book of life their name. And it's there to show that they are going to spend eternity with him. Now the works will be judged, but first you have to get your name written in the Lamb's book of life. And you don't get your name in that book through works. You don't get your name in that book through doing good or being good. You don't get your name in that book because of a special deal that you made with someone or something. But it comes through salvation, being washed in the blood of the Lamb, being redeemed, being born again, being transformed, being changed. If you haven't experienced change, then you are not born again. I'm going to let that sink in. If you have not experienced change, Jesus didn't save you so that you could be a part, he could be a part of the life that you already have. He saved you to give you new life and life abundantly. So the question might be then, well, I got my name in the Lamb's book of life. Does that lock me in? Some denominations, some groups would say, yeah, once you do it, you're locked in. How many would love that to be true? I would. I mean, I get saved. Whoo, it's over. I'm in, baby. But the scripture doesn't bear that out for me. Is it possible to lose my salvation? 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 1 says, my friend, I want you to remember the message that I preached and that you believed and trusted. You will be saved by this message if you hold firmly to it. Does that leave any question? You will be saved by this message if you hold firmly to it. But if you don't, your faith, which you had previously but didn't hold on to, was all for nothing. Let me read this scripture again. My friends, I want you to remember the message that I preached and that you believed and trusted. You will be saved by this message if you hold firmly to it. But if you don't, your faith was all for nothing. We've got to reach some people that think once they were saved, that was it, and they can live how they want and not honor God and still go to heaven. Revelation 3:5, everyone who wins the victory will wear white clothes. Their names will not be erased from the book of life. If they finish well, their names won't be erased. What does that tell you if they don't finish well? These are just, let me read this again. Everyone who wins the victory will wear white clothes. Their names will not be erased from the book of life. And I will tell my Father and his angels that they are my followers. Look at the story of the prodigal son. We break that all down to the point of he was with his father. They were in relationship together. The prodigal son said, I want to break this relationship. I want my inheritance. I want to leave. I want to go do what I want to do. And that's what he did. And as long as he was out there, the father was seeking him but didn't have him. It wasn't until the son returned. And I believe that's the story of the prodigal son. Someone who knows Christ, leaves Christ, and needs to come back to find salvation. The fact is, those who rejected Christ, not allowed him to be Lord and King of their lives, are excluded from the book of life. And if you're excluded from the book of life, your destiny, your eternity, is a real and terrible, awful hell that never ends with you. Matthew 7:21. Not everyone who calls me their Lord will get into the kingdom of heaven. Only the ones who obey my Father in heaven will get in. On the day of judgment, many will call me their Lord. They will say, we preached in your name, and in your name we forced out demons and worked many miracles. But I will tell them, I will have nothing to do with you. Get out of my sight, you evil people. That's the great white throne judgment. The judgment seat of Christ. That's for the believers, and that's what we want to be a part of. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 9. Says, but whether we are at home with the Lord or away from him, we still try our best to please him. After all, Christ will judge each of us for the good or the bad that we do while living in these bodies. That's the judgment seat of Christ. Now, some people call it, and the term comes forward, the Bema seat. The term the Bema seat, the judgment seat at the end of the race is the Bema seat, giving the award after the finish line has been crossed. In that judgment, what will you be judged on? Well, you've already been judged that you're saved if you're at that judgment. So why would there be a judgment if you've already been judged to be saved? Well, you'll be judged on what you did with the gospel of Jesus Christ. The question being, did you love people? Did you love the Father? Real love. I'm not talking about lip service. We've all had that. Someone says, I love you, but you know what that means? Everything changed. I love you, but we've got to deal with something. I love you, but this happened. I love you, but someone else came along. Do we really love God? Do we really love people? You're going to be judged on that. I'm going to be judged on that. I'm going to be judged on, did I speak life? I'll be honest with you. I was struggling with that today. I hope you people love this truth. This has been a tough week. And my emotional response, when we came in to start worship practice, I had started by saying, my nerves are shot. Matter of fact, I walked over to Pastor Rick this morning and I said, you ready to go? Yeah. I said, I'm ready to hurt somebody. And so my natural response is, isn't this bad? That's terrible. Jesus Christ is looking for me to say, here's life. And I've got to speak life. I'm going to be judged on that. You'll be judged on how you stewarded the gifts that God has given. I know we just got done with stewardship as a series, and God has blessed us through that. But it goes beyond tithe and offering. Some of you have the gift of hospitality, but you're not opening your homes. Some of you have the gift of helps, but you're not stepping up. Some of you have the gift of evangelism, but you're not speaking out. Some of you have the gift of prophecy, but you're not prophesying. Some of you have the gift of teaching, but you're not teaching. All of us have these gifts that we've got to steward. Something else is God's looking at is how you endure suffering. How do you bear up under the suffering of this life. You know, Romans says trials work perseverance. Perseverance gives us proven character. Proven character gives us hope. And hope will never disappoint us. It talks about being tested by fire and heat. How do you hold up under suffering? And I believe the biggest one is going to be, did you lead anybody to Jesus Christ? And that's not necessarily being the one that stands with them at the altar or kneels with them, tells them what to pray or asks them how they can pray with them. It may be that you demonstrated the light of the gospel of Jesus Christ, and that was part of the seed that was planted in them that would later be harvested. I want you to imagine with me this morning, standing there before him, King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, then kneeling, then even bowing down, and taking the crown off your head and placing it at his feet. What are you going to hear on that day? What will you see? Rewards that I'm sure you're expecting. It may be the fact that you know people that you led to Jesus Christ, and that's going to be part of your reward. There's money that you gave to missions, that's going to be part of your reward. Maybe you taught Sunday school, that's going to be part of your reward. Or the people that you prayed for regularly that God moved on, that's going to be part of your reward. Maybe you sacrificially gave to help in different situations. Or maybe you suffered a lot for the sake of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And Scripture tells us you're going to get rewards for that, but I can't help but believe that what will be the greatest reward are those rewards that you didn't even realize. I was telling the board Monday at our meeting. I remember calling up Brother Al, my pastor. I hadn't spoken to him for a long time. He answered the phone. I said, "Brother Al." He said, "Hey, Rusty, how you doing?" I said, I'm doing good, Brother Al. How you doing?" He said, "Good. We just started talking." He said, "They haven't been talking long." He said, "Oh, wait. I got somebody here that wants to talk to you." And he hands the phone off. And I thought, my pastor. I haven't talked to him for months. And as soon as I get him on the phone, he hands it off to somebody else. What's this about? And a voice comes on the phone and says, "Hey, Pastor Rusty, this is Dwayne Holt. You remember me?" And I said, "Oh, yeah, Dwayne. I remember you down in Hurley, Mississippi, in my youth group. How you doing?" He said, "Good." He said, "I want to tell you something." I said, "Okay." He said, "Do you remember the first time we met?" And I said, "Yeah, Dwayne, I remember." You see, Dwayne's cousin, James, came walking in. Dwayne's walking behind him, and Dwayne, he was a skinny kid, little guy. Had a long stringy hair, and he walked slumped over, and he was shy. James said, this is my cousin Dwayne. I put my hand out, and I said, "Hey, Dwayne, it's good to have you here with us." And he said, "I don't shake hands." And I thought, well, that's different. I said, "That's cool. It's still good to have you here. I'm glad you're here." Well, slowly I figured out that Dwayne had a condition that caused his hands to be sweaty all the time, and it was embarrassing for him. I've worked with Dwayne as much as he'd allow me, and I saw him grow and develop a little bit. Then God called me to come back to Ohio and pastor a church, so I resigned there. And Dwayne said, "You didn't know it, but I've been in a few churches, and I wasn't really sure about this whole God thing, but he said, you loved me. And you encouraged me, and you accepted me in." He said, "And I know even after you accepted me in, I wasn't the one you could count on. I wasn't there all the time. I wasn't doing all the things I should, but it still meant a lot to me. And it's always stuck with me." He said, I just got back from Africa. And I had the privilege of designing and installing all the components for a full-size radio station in an area where the gospel had not been preached And now the gospel is being broadcast to a huge area of Africa that never had the gospel. And he said, it all happened because of you. Those things that we don't even know. How was I to know that scrawny little kid was going to be an incredible asset for the kingdom of God? You want to know why I love our teenagers and our kids when they come in here? Because that might be one of them. That is one of them. They all have that potential. God wants to use them in that way. And I want to be used in that because one day I'm going to hear him say, you did good. I want to hear him say, well done, my good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over the few things I've given you. I'm going to make you a ruler. I know other people have things in this life that I'll never have. Can I tell you a secret? I hurt for them because they won't have what I'm going to have forever. Eternity, forever. This morning, you've been given these timers. Put them somewhere that you'll see them. Turn it over every time you see it. Not only think about what's going to happen my first minute in heaven. Can I change that? Can I do something starting this week? Not a one-time event, but a change of life. What can I do this week to change eternity? To change the direction my life will head during that first minute in heaven. We're talking about life after death. You never really die. First minute in heaven be like? It's all determined by you today. Bow your head to me. Father, thank you. Thank you for life. Life more abundantly. Thank you. Thank you for the saving power of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, that you're laying up treasures for us in heaven. Father, in order to get it, we've got to get there. Lord, I want everyone under the sound of my voice to be there. Lord, I'm reminded of that song. It's a great morning, that first day in heaven. Streets of gold. We see the saints of old. We see family. We see friends. Most importantly, we see you, Father. We see Jesus Christ. We see your Holy Spirit. Father, we spend our whole lives working for retirement. Are we really working for the retirement? Lord, I pray over each one under the sound of my voice. I pray a transformation is taking place this morning. I pray a breaking, a crushing. Lord, we're just clay. break us to the point of, you said, a broken and a contrite heart, Father, contrite as dust. Break us to that point. That's what you're looking for. So that you can add the water of your word and begin working us back into a moldable piece of clay. Make us into what you want us to be, Father. Now, Father, I pray, first, that each one here today, if they aren't ready to stand in your presence, will change that before they leave this building. Second, we'll change our whole thought process, what the purpose of life is. Pleasing you, Father. Honoring you, and hearing you say, well done. Enter now into the joy. Father, I count this as done. And I speak that blessing into each one of the sound of my voice. In Jesus' name. All God's people said,
Amen.
I've got to get my tithe in. Let's make our offering proclamation together. I sow my finances into the kingdom of God. The gospel will be preached in all the world. Lives will be set free. And the kingdom of Satan will be stopped. It will produce for God and for me good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. I count it as done in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Lord bless you. Have a wonderful, wonderful day. It is beautiful outside. God is changing your life.